Good evening. Welcome to our School of the Bible class tonight. I believe we're on, is it lesson seven we're on tonight? And so week seven, I believe that's right. And so we only got a few more weeks to go. I'll just remind you again. Week eight. Okay, that's my bad. Okay, so we're closer to the end than I thought. So week eight, and so Pastor corrected me there. I stand corrected. But anyway, tonight, and then next week, we're going to have our School of the Bible again on Thursday. Pastor, you turn me down just a little bit on this mic. But next Thursday, we'll have School of the Bible because we have our mission conference, and that starts this Sunday and goes through Wednesday. So we thank God for that. And the opportunity to support our missionaries, so Brother Ron Cole will be here to church. But anyway, we're here for School of the Bible tonight, and we thank you, those of you who have come out tonight and those of you who are watching live stream. And we'll get started in the book of 1 Corinthians for our New Testament survey class tonight. And we're going to look at the book of 1 Corinthians. So go ahead and turn your Bible there. And I want to open up with a word of prayer tonight. Heavenly Father, Lord, we thank you for the beautiful day that you have given us. Father, we thank you, Lord, for people who are interested in studying the Word of God. And so, God, I pray, Lord, as pastors and teachers, Lord, that, Lord, that you'll help us, dear Father, to help our people to communicate truth, and, Lord, that we might win a lost and dying world to Jesus Christ. So, Father, we thank you, Lord, for this church and its and the privilege to serve here. So, God, we ask you to bless our people and bless those who have tuned in tonight and those who are here. In Jesus' name, and amen. All right, the book of 1 Corinthians, of course. Now, remember we said from Romans all the way to 2 Thessalonians is going to be Paul's church epistles. And so, and then we'll get into some of the pastoral epistles and then the Jewish Christian epistles. But now we're still in the church epistles, and we're going to only get through, I think, Ephesians maybe this semester, and we'll pick up in Philippians. But tonight we're looking at 1 Corinthians, and so from here on out, the rest of this semester, all the books of the Bible will be studying. Paul is the human author. So look in 1 Corinthians chapter 1 and verse number 1. Paul, called to be an apostle of Jesus Christ through the will of God, and Sosthenes, our brother, unto the church of God which is at Corinth, and to them that are sanctified in Christ Jesus, called to be saints with all that are in every place, call upon the name of Jesus Christ our Lord, both theirs and ours. And so Paul, he's writing to the church at Corinth. And so remember, these books of the Bible, Corinthians and Thessalonians and Philippians and Ephesians, they were named after those churches and those cities and those areas. And so Paul is writing to a body of believers in Corinth, the Corinthian church, okay? And so we're going to look at that tonight. Now, if you want the historical background, you go back to the book of Acts and look in chapter 18, verses 1 through 18. And that kind of tells you about Paul's time there at Corinth and gives you a little bit of insight in that. His first visit there, anyway, is recorded in Acts chapter 18. This church was in the midst of a wicked city. And so there was immorality all around, idol worship, and especially in Corinth. If you study much about it, and we're not going to get into graphic details tonight, but if you study much about that, their idolatry was connected to fornication and wickedness, immorality, ungodliness. And so that was a part of that pagan religion. And so this church is right in the midst of this wicked, dark city. Okay, and so it's a light in their community. Now, they're going to have a lot of problems in the Corinthian church, and we'll study about that a little bit later. Now, look at your next line there. In your book, it'll have some letters spelled out in the Greek. If you want to pronounce that, you go right ahead. But we're going to tell you what it means. It means to act the Corinthian. And so that was a phrase, or that's been a phrase, to act the Corinthian. But what it literally means, it means to commit fornication. And so that fornication is sexual immorality outside of a marriage relationship. And so that's what the Bible calls fornication. And this is what is happening here, and this is the major thing that's happening in this city of Corinth. And so the date of this writing is around AD 53. So about the middle of the first century is when Paul would write here. And 1st and 2nd Corinthians were actually written just prior to Romans. And so understand that in your Bible. Just because the books are placed the way they are in the Bible doesn't mean that's chronologically where they were. Remember, we studied a lot about when we went through the prophets, an Old Testament survey, you know, that some of them were way out here, you know, and they're at different places. So chronologically, Corinthians comes before the book of Romans, okay? And so now, let's go to the next slide, please. The theme of this book, the theme of it is carnal Christians or fleshly Christians. Look in chapter 3. Verses 1 through 3, we have several scriptures to look at here tonight. I want to try to move along to look at them. 1 Corinthians chapter 3, and here's one of the reasons that Paul is writing to them. In verse 1, "And I, brethren, could not speak unto you as spiritual, but as unto carnal, even as unto babes in Christ." And so the carnal Christian is a baby Christian. He's an immature Christian. He's one that has not grown in the Lord. And of course, we can make a lot of analogies there. You know, a baby demands constant attention. A baby, the only thing they're interested in is me. Me, 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 me. It's all about me. It's all about my way. And I didn't get the toy that I wanted. The preacher didn't shake my hand. I mean, that's what a baby Christian does, immature Christians. And may God help us tonight not to be immature Christians. We kind of laugh and giggle at that, but the reality of it is the churches are full of immature Christians, people who are not growing in the Lord, people who are self-centered, people who think the pastor has nothing else better to do than to visit them every 3 days of the week. And so there's a lot of people like that, and they cause divisions and they cause problems. That's what's happening in the Corinthian church. I'm going to move on before I start preaching. Verse number 2. "I have fed you with milk." You know why? Because a baby can't eat meat. All right? And so a lot of the problems in church is because of spiritual babies. "I have fed you with milk and not with meat, for hitherto you were not able to bear it. Neither yet are you now able." And so Paul said, it's time for you to be eating on the meat of the word. He said, but I still got to feed you the simple things because it's not registered yet. It's not clicked yet. You're still battling problems with the flesh. How can you go into the deeper things of God and the bigger things of God when you're still out here trying to live in the world and act like the world and smell like the world and come to church on Sunday morning thinking everything's okay? Paul said, you're baby Christians. "For ye are yet carnal," that means fleshly, not spiritual, "for whereas there is among you envying," and here's some of the marks of their spiritual immaturity. Envying, they're envying one another, jealous about one another. There's strife, and the Bible said strife only comes by contention and pride. And so anywhere there's strife and pride and envying, there's pride, and divisions, are you not carnal, walk as men. And so people in the church today trying to cause divisions because they don't get their way and they're not pampered and people's not catering to them. And so that's not what it's about. It's about serving the Lord and keeping our eyes on Christ. And so Paul is reminding them. And so this kind of a letter here is a reproof, okay? And so it's really dealing with their practical Christianity. The book of Corinthians is not really as much as a doctrinal correction, but it deals with a reproof. It deals with their practical living. And so their doctrine may have been in line, but their practical Christian living wasn't. They were living in immorality. They were doing things that Christians shouldn't do. And so Paul's having to write them to address these situations in the church. This church had problems not with heresy. That's a doctrinal thing. It wasn't the doctrine they were teaching, but carnality. And I'm afraid that's what is plaguing a lot of churches today. It's not doctrinally. You know, a lot of the churches, you know, you can go around here and they say they believe in the Word of God and that Jesus is the only way of salvation and they believe in the virgin birth and the deity of Christ. And so doctrinally, they may be okay that way. But when it comes to this practical side of Christianity, they're carnal because they're living in the world. Let's just bring in the world's music. Let's just quit having church services. Let's just get another Bible. Let's just do what the people want us to have. Let's have a contemporary service and a traditional service. And so that's carnality, okay? Catering to people. Carnal equals fleshly. It's the opposite of spiritual. So know that when you see that word carnal in the Bible, it's not a good thing. It's the opposite of spiritual. And so we are to be walking in the Spirit, not in the flesh. Carnality will manifest itself in contention in the church family. So here's some evidence of carnality or fleshly behavior in people. And it's not that you have to go around calling people out, but just watch. If you'll watch, you'll see this to be true. Contention in the church family. There was contention at Corinth. Look in chapter 1, verses 10 and 11. chapter 1, verses 10 and 11. He said, "Now I beseech you, brethren, by the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, that ye all speak the same thing." We're to be of one mind. We are to be in unity. The Bible said how sweet it is for the brethren to dwell in unity. Okay, and he says that y'all speak the same thing, and that there be no divisions among you, but that ye be perfectly joined together in the same mind and in the same judgment. For it hath been declared unto me of you, my brethren, by them which are of the house of Chloe, that there are contentions among you. And so sometimes this happens. It shouldn't happen in churches. But sometimes in churches, there get to be little cliques. And you have this clique here and this clique over here. And we have the right side and the left side and the uppity side and the down side. And we have all these little cliques getting together. And before long, there's division in the church. Then we have some that, well, they believe the pastor and support the pastor. Then we have some, well, we're just going to go see how many people that we can get to be against the pastor. And we'll have our own group that's against the pastor. And then you have the people that's for the pastor. And so before long, there gets to be divisions in the church. And sadly, usually, and see, the devil's very good at his job. He's been at this for a century. He knows what he's doing. And usually about 90-some percent of the time, the problems that you have in church with divisions is usually never over anything spiritual. It's over things like the color of the carpet or how many deacons we're going to have on a deacon board or blah, blah. I mean, just all of these things that are really, when it comes to eternity, don't amount to a hill of beans. But the devil uses those things, and he uses our personalities if we're not careful in our opinions. And you know how people are. We're all this way. We tend to be opinionated about things, and it's okay to have an opinion. But but when we come together, we need to understand that there's going to be some times that we have to agree to disagree. And now when it comes to the virgin birth and the deity of Christ and Jesus is God and He's the only way of salvation, we're not moving on those things. But listen, we have to understand when you got here at Maranatha Church, we've seen the day when there's been 300 people here on a Sunday morning. And when you get 300 people together anywhere, in a church, in Walmart, at a ball game, that's 300 different points of views. That's 300 different opinions, and we're all different. But we understand we need to be of the same mind. And when we come together, our mind needs to be on Christ to worship. And when we're talking about the work of the church, our mind needs to be united that what does God want us to do? It's not about me. It's not about what color I want the carpet to be. But the reason that we come together, the reason that we have church, is there's a lost and dying world out there that needs the gospel of Jesus Christ. So what can I do as a member of my local church to support my pastor, to support my church, to support the Word of God, to get lost people in my community saved? What can I do? That needs to be all of our goals. No matter from the preacher all the way down to the nursery worker, all the way down to the bus driver, all the way down to the Sunday school teacher, our goal needs to be united, that we're doing what we do for the gospel of Jesus Christ. Amen? All right, that's right, Joe. Tell him. All right, but there was contention. There was contention, and we read about it in chapter 3 and verse 3, the divisions among them. Okay, number 2. Not only was there, now we're talking about the evidence of carnality or how carnality manifests itself in the church. Number 1, contention. You know, and contention always rears its head. People, y'all have no idea. The people come to the pastor, well, I want things my way. I want it done this way. You didn't do this. And people constantly, y'all have no idea. Pray for your pastor. Please pray for your pastor. But contention, that's an evidence of carnality. You know, I've had people come to me and I try to be as kind and nice as I can be, but I really want to say to them, did you pray about that before you come into my office? Before you brought this matter that you're so hot about, that you're so mad about, did you pray about it? Do you have a verse of Scripture that backs up what point you're trying to argue with me? And I've not done that yet. I might do it next time. So next time, y'all beware. I might ask you for a verse and ask you if you prayed about it. But anyway, that would solve a lot of that. But usually, it's over immature things. So contention. And then a condoning of sin. Now, the Corinthian church, now remember, they have just been saved out of this pagan idolatry, especially as it deals with fornication and immorality, and it was all around them. And it's almost like the world we live in today as Christians in this dark world that we live in. There is filth and pornography and sin and wickedness. I mean, you can't even watch TV anymore. We got rid of our satellite and all those things. We never could get cable out where we live, but we got rid of all that junk because all the commercials is just one after another. And then now if you got one of these internet things and they got commercials, commercials on them too. But it's just all around you. And so if we're not careful, we tend to let our guard down. You know, the reason they're giving you all those programs and those commercials with that filth on it, they're programming you, because the more you see of that, the less your guard is up. And the more, well, I've seen that before. I've already seen that. And before long, your guard's down and it slips in. But we as children of God must be careful not to allow this immorality, ungodliness, that with the world that we live in, to slip into our churches. And that's what was happening at Corinth. Look in chapter 5 and verse number 1. And so Paul is kind of writing this letter as a rebuke to them, dealing with their carnality. And that's what you have to do. You have to deal with it. You know, we're saying that carnality is like babies. How do you deal with babies when they throw temper tantrums and fits? What do? You got to discipline them. You got to punish them, right? And so, same thing in the church, all right? Amen. I'm going to preach here in a minute, Pastor. All right, 1 Corinthians chapter 5 and verse 1. Paul said it's reported commonly, this wasn't even a secret, that there is fornication among you. Okay, that's pretty bad. But now look what it says. And such fornication as is not so much named among the Gentiles. And Paul said, what I'm hearing is worse than if I'm hearing it out here in the world coming off of the streets. That it says that one should have his father's wife. And so that, I mean, you take that for what it is there. And that's what was going on in Corinth. Now, outside the walls of the church, no doubt that was probably a common practice, and no doubt it was accepted in the community, and no doubt in the Corinthian society that was accepted and it was okay. That's just a lifestyle that they chose to live. But Paul, as the man of God, as a word from God, tells that church that is wrong, it's sin. It says that's worse than even the wicked people. So what kind of a testimony or an influence does a carnal Christian have? None. They have no wit. They're too busy self-centered. They're too busy crying about themselves. They're too busy pleasing the flesh, doing what they want to do, running here and there, doing what they want to do. Well, we'll come to church if we feel like it. We'll do this if we feel like it. But the whole world revolves around me. It's all about me. How many people do you think that person's winning to Jesus Christ? None, because their life centers around themselves. In order to be a soul winner, in order to take the gospel to a lost and dying world, you have to get self out of the way, and you got to put yourself into some inconvenient situations where it's not about you anymore, but it's about the lost and dying souls of men. And that's what Paul was trying to tell him. And that's the business of the church. It's not so that we can sit here and be comfortable. It's not so that everybody can pamper us and wait on us. But our goal and our mission is to be united to get the gospel to a lost and dying world. That's what the gospel's all about. And I'm probably spending more time here than I should. But look in chapter 6, verse 18 through 20. The condoning of sin was happening. So marks of carnality, contention in the church family, condoning of sin. And they were allowing it to go on without correction. But Paul's calling them out on it. And so what happens when the preacher calls people out on their sin? Well, they usually get mad and find them in another church somewhere. All right, in chapter 6 and verse 18. Flee fornication, and every sin that a man doeth is without the body. But he that committeth fornication sinneth against his own body. And that's very serious. Look in verse 19. What? Know ye not that your body is the temple of the Holy Ghost, which is in you, which ye have of God? You're not your own. You know, people say, well, here's a mark of a carnal Christian. I'll do what I want to do. You preacher or God or nobody else going to tell me, I'll do what I want to do. That's not what the Bible said. Paul said we're not our own. Look at verse 20. For ye are bought with a price, therefore glorify God in your body and in your spirit, which are God's. And we can spend much more time on that point. But there was contention in the church family. There was a condoning of sin. And then number 3, there was carelessness in their worship. Carelessness in their worship and conduct. Now, I want you to go to 1 Corinthians chapter number 11. It's not in your book, but I wrote this in. There's several other examples that you can look at and how they were kind of, they had become careless in their worship. What do you expect? If there's divisions in the church, if they're condoning sin, do you think they're going to be careful about how they're worshiping God? No, they're not. They're carnal Christians. They're baby Christians. They're immature Christians. They're not growing in Christ. But I want you to notice this. I want us to read 1 Corinthians chapter 11. And verses 28 through 31. Now, this is the chapter that we read every time that we take the Lord's table. We do communion. And so it's a very serious thing. And you know, we usually read verses 23 through 25 as we're observing the table. But it would do us well to understand the context of this chapter, that Paul is writing this telling them about the Lord's table, they were doing it unworthily. They were coming to God's table. And that's one of the most serious times of worship that we have, as we remember the body and the blood of Jesus Christ and the price that was paid for our redemption. And as we come together to search ourselves for sin and to ask God to cleanse us, and we're looking back at what Jesus did for us, we're looking forward to His return. It's a time of cleansing. It's a time of purifying. And it's a time that we ought to take very seriously. But many, like the Corinthians, weren't. And so if we would read past verses 24 and 25 and go down to verse 28, the Bible says, "But let a man examine himself." And this is in direct context with the Lord's table. "But let a man examine himself, and so let him eat of that bread and drink of that cup. For he that eateth and drinketh unworthily eateth and drinketh damnation to himself, not discerning the Lord's body. For this cause," now here, Paul's pointing this out. He said, here's why there's problems in your church. Verse 30, "For this cause many are weak and sickly among you, and many sleep." Or that means many of your church has died because you're not observing the Lord's table with the right heart and the right manner. Look in verse 31, "For if we would judge ourselves, we should not be judged." And so where does judging begin? It begins on the inside. Paul said, "Examine yourself." Look in 32. "But when we are judged, we are chastened of the Lord, and that we should not be condemned with the world. Wherefore, my brethren, when you come together to eat, tarry one for another. And if any man hunger, let him eat at home, that ye come not together unto condemnation. And the rest will I set in order when I come." And so they were careless in their worship. And there's other examples here that you could look at for this. Now, next slide, please. Okay, some of the key words here in the book of Corinthians, love. You'll find, of course, a whole chapter on love. What chapter is that? 1 Corinthians what? 13, right? On charity, that's love. Then there's a whole chapter on the resurrection. What chapter is that? 15, chapter 15, the last, I think it's next to the last chapter. Chapter 15 is about the resurrection. And then the words cross, spirit, body. Okay, you'll read a lot about the body of Christ in chapter 12 and the Spirit. And you'll read about the gifts from like chapters like 12 through 14 are about spiritual gifts. And then wisdom, you'll find the word wisdom. These are some of the key words. Okay, the key verse or verses actually is 1 Corinthians 15, 57 and 58. The Bible says, "But thanks be unto God, which giveth us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. Therefore, my beloved brethren, be ye steadfast, unmovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord." So what's Paul? Now, Paul's being tender with them. He's being firm. You know, a pastor sometimes has to be firm, but he can do it in love. The Bible said that we speak the truth in love. And so Paul is speaking the truth in love. And so Paul is giving them, instead of just downing them for being carnal Christian, Paul's giving them the solution. You ever heard the phrase, you know, be part of the solution, not the problem, okay? So Paul's not adding to the problem, he's giving them the solution. Here it is. He says, "Be steadfast and unmovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord." Faithfulness. What's the cure for carnality? Faithfulness. Faithfulness in the Word of God. Faithfulness in prayer. Faithfulness in church attendance. Faithfulness in the work of God. Serving God in your local church. Being there for whatever's going on. Helping in any way you can. That's the cure for it. That's how you grow in the Lord. "Always abounding in the work of the Lord, for as much as you know that your labor is not in vain in the Lord." Okay, next slide. Special features in this book. Two of them we've already mentioned. Key chapters, the love chapter or the charity chapter, chapter 13, and then the resurrection chapter, chapter 15. And so I'd encourage you to, we're talking about in some of our classes studying the Bibles, you know, you could take, you're studying a theme, talking about love or charity. There you go. Study 1 Corinthians 13. You want to talk about the resurrection, 1 Corinthians 15, a wonderful chapter to do that. You want to talk about the church as the body of Christ, 1 Corinthians chapter 12, wonderful chapter to do that. Talking about the unity. Okay, some key subjects here that are mentioned in this book. The preaching of the cross. Wow, I want you to see this in 1 Corinthians chapter 1. I love this passage of Scripture, 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verses 18 through 24. 1 Corinthians 1, 18 through 24, "For the preaching of the cross is to them that perish foolishness, But unto us which are saved, it is the power of God. So to the world, what we're doing tonight, this is foolishness. This is ignorance. They would laugh at what we are doing, studying the Bible, preaching the Bible. But Paul said to those of us who are saved, you see, the world don't know what we know. They don't have the inside scoop. They're void of the Holy Spirit of God. But you and I know that our power lies in the preaching of the cross of Jesus Christ, because that's the only thing that can save a soul. Look in verse 19. For as it is written, I will destroy the wisdom, there's the word wisdom, of the wise, and will bring to nothing the understanding of the prudent. Where is the wise? Where is the scribe? Where is the disputer of this world? Hath not God made foolish the wisdom of this world? For after that, in the wisdom of God, the world by wisdom knew not God. It pleased God by the foolishness of preaching to save them that believe. Now notice what Paul says here. It pleased God by the foolishness of preaching to save them that believe. Now it didn't say foolish preaching. There's a whole lot of foolish preaching going on today that are not preaching the Bible. But the Bible, now that goes back to verse number 18. The world thinks of preaching the cross is foolishness. But that's exactly the way that God has chosen for the message of the gospel to get out. And not just from preachers who stand in a pulpit, but do you realize that every day that you're out on your job, every day that you're with your family, every day that you go to town, every day that you go out of your house, that you are preaching the gospel of Jesus Christ. You are taking that message with you. But the world thinks that's foolish. Look in verse 22. For the Jews require a sign, and the Greeks seek after wisdom, but we preach Christ crucified, and to the Jews a stumbling block, and to the Greeks foolishness. Now remember, I'm going to back up just a little bit. Remember, we're talking verse 22 there. We talked about the book of Acts. Remember we talked about the apostles and the gifts that ended with the apostles? Well, here's the reason why in verse 22. For the Jews require a sign, and those miracles were given to the Jewish people. That's why Christ did miracles, and that's why the apostles did miracles, to prove to the Jewish people that Jesus was the Christ, the Messiah. They required a sign. And remember, Jesus told them that a wicked and perverse generation seeketh after a sign. But anyway, just a note of thought is passing. Verse 23, but we preach Christ crucified. Now the Jews wanted to see a sign from God. They wanted to see a miracle. They wanted to see the parting of the Red Sea. They wanted to see all these big miracles from God. But the Greeks, the other people group in the world of that day, the Greeks were the cultural group or the educated group. Remember in Acts 17 when Paul goes to Athens, they laughed at him when he preached about the resurrection of Christ. Only a few believed, and there was never a church started in Athens, Greece, because that was the center of philosophy. And you go and study some of these perverted Bibles today, and they have their traces back to people like Plato that comes out of Greek culture and Greek philosophy. I don't have time to expand on that tonight, but you better get you a King James Bible. Amen. I'll leave it at that. Verse 24, but unto them which are called, both Jews and Greeks, Christ the power of God and the wisdom of God. And so the preaching of the cross is found. Now look in chapter 2, verses 1 through 5. Again, powerful scriptures. And now Paul's just being real with these people. And he says, and I, brethren, when I came to you, came not with excellency of speech or wisdom declaring unto you the testimony of God. You know, Paul wasn't trying to be the lead evangelist of the day, and Paul wasn't trying to be the one that signed the most Bibles, and Paul wasn't the one that was trying to be on the most billboards or had the biggest followers on Facebook. Paul said, the only reason that I come to you was to preach the gospel of Jesus Christ. And he said, I might not be a very good preacher, but I'm going to be the best that God's called me to be with the abilities and gifts that God's given me to be. And I don't care if my name's ever in lights. I don't care if I have a million followers on Facebook. I'm just going to simply preach the gospel of Jesus Christ. And that's what Paul did. Look in verse 2. For I determined, Paul determined ahead of time, not to know anything among you save Jesus Christ and Him crucified. What else matters? Really, in the grand scheme of things, if somebody's lost and on their way to hell, all the rest of the things in the church doesn't matter until they get that matter of salvation settled. So remember, Paul is coming to these pagan people. They've never heard about Jesus. They didn't know about the gospel. They didn't know how to be saved. They were living in idolatry. And so Paul wasn't there to try to be a great speaker and a great orator. And Paul didn't say, look what degree I got from blah, blah, Bible college. Paul said, I've been called of Christ. You need Jesus, and that's what I'm going to preach to you. And in verse 3, and I was with you in weakness and in fear, much trembling. And my speech and my preaching was not with enticing words of man's wisdom, but in the demonstration of the Spirit and of power, that your faith should not stand in the wisdom of men, but in the power of God. Paul was not going around to all these cities trying to develop a following for himself. Paul was going around pointing men and women, lost and dying souls, to the Lord Jesus Christ. That was Paul's job. He was pointing them to the cross, pointing them to Jesus. And every God-called preacher, that's our job, that's our mission, that's our responsibility, is not to make a big name for ourselves, but to leave all that in the Lord's hands and point people to the Lord Jesus Christ. That's what we'll be judged on. So, the preaching of the cross. And then, number two, Christian liberty. Christian liberty, okay? Now, I want to say this. Liberty is not license. And we believe, as independent fundamental Baptists, we believe in individual soul liberty. That once, you know, that we're saved, that God's given us a free will, and that we're not under the restraints of anybody else to tell us how to live. You know, if you're living for the Lord and you're truly saved, the Holy Spirit will convict you of sin. You don't have to have a preacher following you around. You'll know what's right and wrong. You spend time in the Bible will convict you. The Holy Spirit will convict you. But that doesn't mean, you know, and a lot of people are void of conviction today. But the reason they're void of conviction is because they don't spend time in the Bible. Spending time in the Word of God will produce convictions in your life. Not a list of what the Baptist church says you have to follow. Not a list of what the preacher says, the do's and the don'ts. No, you allow the Lord to work in and through your life. God will make those things absolutely clear in your life. And, you know, I've heard people say, well, the Lord don't convict me about this. You know, really, people living in ungodly lifestyles, well, I'm not convicted about that. Well, it makes you wonder how much time they spend in the Word of God. You know, I know we're all different people, but if we're in the Bible, we'll have the same convictions about things. It's not about what the preacher says and, you know, do this or don't do that. I mean, you know, there's a lot of do's and don'ts in the Bible. But you'll totally come to submission when you understand who God is and you understand His Word. And that's what Paul's talking about, Christian liberty. But liberty is not a license to sin. Just because God saved us by grace doesn't mean we can go out here and live any way we want to. That's what Paul's talking about. Now, there's some examples in your book, but I want you to look in chapter 10 and verse 23. This is not in your book. And I thought this was a better example, so I'm going to give you this one. Chapter 10 and verse 23. Paul says, all things are lawful for me, but all things are not expedient. All things are lawful for me, but all things edify not. The word edify means to build up. So in other words, you know, Paul says, you know, I'm saved. I'm going to heaven. That's not going to change. But that doesn't mean that I can do anything I want to do. It's not expedient. It doesn't going to edify. You know, I would ask you this, and I wish I had time to tell you the story. I don't. But, you know, if you're wondering that thing that you're trying to, you know, here's what a carnal Christian usually tries to do. They try to justify their sin. Instead of getting it right with God, confessing it, making things right, they try to justify it. Well, I don't see anything wrong with it. I don't think there's anything wrong with this. You better be careful when you start making statements like that because that's trending towards carnality. You better have a Bible conviction. You better have a Bible verse. See what God has to say about that thing you're trying to justify in your life. Because if it doesn't edify or build up some other Christian, if you doing that thing in public would hinder somebody from coming to Christ, 99% of the time that's probably going to be a carnal thing in your life. And carnality is always flesh-driven, and the flesh is always contrary to the Spirit. And so if your habit or whatever it is, if it's fleshly, then it's carnal, okay? It's not of the Spirit, okay? And that's all of our lives, okay? And so that's just a good test, and that can apply to a vast array of things in our life. So understand this, if that thing in your life, just because you're saved, doesn't mean you can do what you want to do. Now, we're saved, we're going to heaven. That's not going to change. But let me ask you this. By doing that certain thing in your life, how's it going to help somebody else? Is it going to cause somebody else to come to Christ, or is it going to push them away from Christ? Will you be able to witness to somebody while you're doing that thing that you're trying to justify, or would that turn somebody away from Christ? And so that ought to be the answer. And you read about what Paul says. Paul said, hey, if it's something that's going to keep somebody from coming to Christ, I'm just not going to do it. That was Paul's final answer. So read those chapters on that. And then, number three, the purity of the body. And of course, we read about it, that our body is the temple of the Holy Spirit. These are some key subjects of purity. Of course, understand, Paul's dealing with immorality and fornication in the Corinthian church. Number four, the Lord's table, memorial supper. We read about that. That's some of the key subjects. And then chapter 14, the ever-famous chapter on tongues, okay? And so you can read about that, and we're not getting into that tonight, all right? And so, but if you want a Bible answer, read that. Read the second chapter of the book of Acts and come to a full understanding of the second chapter of the book of Acts, and then go read 1 Corinthians 14, and you'll have a complete understanding about tongues in the Bible. Okay, last slide, and I'm a little bit over here. I'm preaching more than I'm teaching tonight. Christ in the book, in chapter 1 and verse number 24, chapter 1 and verse 24, we read this a while ago, but we'll look at it again since we're speaking of Jesus. That's right, buddy, speaking of Jesus. He said, "But unto them which are called, both Jews and Greeks, Christ the power of God and the wisdom of God." So Christ is the power and the wisdom of God. The Bible said in Him dwells all the fullness of the Godhead bodily. And Colossians says that all the treasures of wisdom and knowledge are hid in Him. Okay, in chapter 1, verse 30, "But of Him," that's, "are ye in Christ," Jesus, excuse me, who of God is made unto us wisdom and righteousness and sanctification and redemption." And so the only way that we have righteousness in our life is through Christ. The only way that we have sanctification in our life is through Jesus Christ. And the only way that we have redemption in our life is through Jesus Christ. And then He's the first fruits. Look in chapter 15. He's the first fruits of them that slept. And so Christ is the only one. Now, were there other people in the Bible raised from the dead? But did they raise themselves from the dead? The only one that raised himself from the dead was Jesus Christ, okay? All the others died. Lazarus and the rest of them died. And so He's the first fruits, chapter 15 and verse 20. "But now is Christ risen from the dead and become the first fruits of them that slept." And then look down at verse 23. "But every man in his own order, Christ the first fruits, afterwards they that are Christ at His coming." And it's interesting, you begin, this is Easter time, it'd be a good time to start studying the crucifixion, the resurrection. Study around that resurrection, what time it happened. It happened right after the Feast of Unleavened Bread, and Christ arose 3 days later. That's when He was crucified on unleavened bread, and He was buried, and then He arose when the Feast of First Fruits began, when they would bring those first offerings. And so study about that. It'd be a blessing to do that. Don't have time to preach that tonight. It'd be a blessing. Look in verse 45 of this chapter, and He's the last Adam. So what the first Adam messed up, pastor's been preaching a series of messages almost about a year now on Christ and the coming kingdom, finishing up in the book of Revelations. What the first Adam lost, the second Adam, Jesus Christ, came to restore him. Verse 45, "And so as it is written, the first man, Adam, was that made a living soul, and the last Adam," that's Christ, "was made a quickening spirit." And so we're the first man was a living soul, but Jesus came to redeem our soul, body, and our spirit. Amen? So 1 Corinthians. Now next week, we're going to meet again on Thursday, but we'll be looking at 2 Corinthians. Probably out of all of Paul's writings, the 13 books that's accredited to Paul, 2 Corinthians is probably the least formal, and it's the most heartfelt letter that he writes, the book of 2 Corinthians, as he defends his apostleship. Well, let's take about a 4 or 5 minute break, and we'll be right back with Pastor's message on the Christian home.
Okay, well, we're up to our second class tonight on this eighth week of School of the Bible, and our second class each week is that of the Christian home. And if you've been following along with us, we've been going through the important players in the Christian home. And last week, if you remember, we talked about the father, the husband, the dad. And tonight, I think even the next week, we're going to deal with the woman. Tonight, the virtuous woman. So in your Bible, we're going to start in Proverbs chapter 31. And we're going to read a few verses here and some other verses as we look at the virtuous or the godly woman, the God-fearing woman, the woman who has a heart for God, the woman who has a heart to do what God would have her to do. And we're going to start with a theme verse. If you have the book, they have a theme verse there. And that's verse number 10 of Proverbs 31. And the Bible says, "Who can find a virtuous woman? For her price is far above rubies." Now, you know as well as I do that we're living in a world that really wants to redefine that. We live in, our world has gone through tremendous changes over the past few years. We've seen tremendous changes, and especially in morality. And we have witnessed a revolution of moral values. A fierce attack is waged against the God-given man and the God-given woman and the God-given family and the God-given home. Our world is out to attack that. They are attacking that. They want to change it. And they are deceiving many people. They're deceiving many men, deceiving many women, and deceiving many children. And unfortunately, the sad part of that is many, many people are changing, or you might say trading in their honor to what the world wants them to do. Today, the devil has thrown out a plan in our world today. And that plan is basically this: don't be satisfied with who God made you. Change it. See if you can't change it. If you want to be if you're a man, you want to be a woman, well, go do it. And if you're a woman, you want to be a man, go do it. Right? Yeah. And then a whole bunch of other things that you can be if you want to. You see, that's degrading God's value. That's degrading God's plan. As we talk about a virtuous woman tonight, what a place the woman has in the home. You see, I've often heard it said, I think it was been said maybe by Pastor Smith, that as goes the mother, so goes the home. And I believe that. You know, the mother is to be an example in the home, to be a godly example, and to live in a godly manner. The devil wants disruption, and he's getting it in our world today. But the Bible asks this question: who can find a virtuous woman? Now, when you read the book of Proverbs, and we're going to go back and read the first five verses here, Proverbs is written by a mother to her son. Now, most of Proverbs, you could say, would be written by a father to his son. But here in this chapter, we find that this chapter is written by a mother. And it's written to her son, King Lemuel. And let's read these first five verses of Proverbs 31. "The words of King Lemuel, the prophecy that his mother taught him. What, my son, and what the son of my womb, and what the son of my vows? Give not thy strength unto women, nor thy ways to that which destroyeth kings. It is not for kings, O Lemuel, it is not for kings to drink wine, nor for princes strong drink, lest they drink and forget the law and pervert the judgment of any of the afflicted." And so we see in this introduction to this chapter that this is written to a son. The mother would write to a son to give advice to him to avoid certain things. One of those things was to avoid a contentious woman, or a woman who is out for evil, a woman who is living to please other people and not trying to please God. Today, our number one goal as mothers, as fathers, as Christians is to please God, not to please the world. The world will not be satisfied until we're not pleasing God. That's the only way you and I will satisfy the world today. You see, she warns him here not to run after women, to stay away from liquor and all those things, these things that will destroy a home, these things that will bring down the God-given home. She's probably asking that question, who can find a virtuous woman? So today, as we think upon this lesson, let's think about what God has ordained. And we're going to look at some things throughout Scripture of what God has said pertaining to a woman in the home. Now, we know, we've studied this before, that God has given man to be the head of the home. But that doesn't mean the woman doesn't have a job. You see, the woman is to honor the man and help the man and then help lead the home by example, by how they live their life, by what they do not get in. You know, you can be an example as much as what you do as what you don't get involved in. You see, it's important that there's things that we don't get involved in. And Pastor Mays was talking about one of the worst examples of anybody is to get involved in contention in the church. You see, that brings down people. That brings down homes, that brings down churches, that brings down friends. You see, God's not pleased with that. And so we have to be careful what we're agreeing to and what we're doing. We need to have the heart of God. So tonight, we deal with this virtuous woman. And so we have three things we'll talk about. You have them in your workbook there tonight. First of all, the heart of a virtuous woman. The verse we just read, who can find a virtuous woman for a price as far above rubies, causes us to realize that we should be more concerned about our character, or a woman should be more concerned about her character than her accomplishments. What is our character? Of course, men, the same thing for us. What is our character when we go out into the world? What do people see in us? What would they say about us if they tell the truth? You'll see. Now, a lot of people are going to say a lot of things about you. And some of it's not necessarily the truth. But what is our character if we was to be graded on our character, you know, or graded on our accomplishments? There's a lot of people that have great accomplishments but have no character. Amen? It's better to have a good character than great accomplishments. Now, I'm not against great accomplishments, and we ought to try to achieve great goals, but let's do them right. Let's do them good. Let's do them the way God has intended for things to be done. So in order to be concerned about our character and how we present ourselves to a world out there, I want to turn over to 2 Peter. There's some other scripture. I think these are probably listed somewhere in your workbook. 2 Peter chapter number 1. And look with me here at verse 5, starting in verse number 5. Of 2 Peter chapter 1, it says, and besides this, giving all diligence, here's what he says, add to your faith virtue, and to virtue knowledge, and to knowledge temperance, and to temperance patience, and to patience godliness, and to godliness brotherly kindness, and to brotherly kindness charity. For if these things be in you and abound, they make you that ye shall neither be barren nor unfruitful in the knowledge of our Lord Jesus Christ. The Bible gives us clear instructions of the things we are to seek, of the things that we are to try to put in our life and seek in our life. And here Peter listed several of them, virtue and knowledge and temperance and patience and godliness, brotherly kindness, charity. These things profit you. These things help you. These things will bring you to the place that God would have us to be. Whereas if we fill ourselves with hatred and violence and bitterness and anger, they are absolutely not going to bring you to where God wants you. They're going to tear you down. They're going to bring you to a place that you don't even want to be. And so it's important where our heart's at when we walk with God. Women, it's it's important where your heart is when you raise those children and you conduct yourself in the home. As we said about dad, mom will say about mom, children often mimic what mom says and what mom does. Amen? You see? And so it's very important what we say and what we do. It's easy to get involved in conversations. And by the way, can I say mom and dad needs to be careful what they say at the dinner table? Amen? Because little ears will repeat that next day in first grade. Or second. Amen? Hey. Yeah, I told you the story about the preacher. Did I ever tell you a story about the preacher? And they invited him over to dinner. And I don't know if it's a true story or not, but I heard this from another preacher. And he said, they invited the preacher over to supper. And as they were sitting at supper, mom set down turkey. They were having turkey and dressing. And she set the turkey down the table. And the little boy said, well, mom, I thought we was having buzzard for supper. And she said, well, no, we're not having buzzard. We're having turkey. What do you mean, buzzard? She said, well, you said we're having that old buzzard over for dinner tonight. They'll tell on you. Amen. They'll tell on you, so we better be careful at what we say. Amen. Oh, yeah. Many of you folks in the church, if you knew what some of your kids told me, you probably wouldn't know what they told me. But anyway, we need to be setting that example. You see, what is in our heart will come out our mouth. Amen? And so the heart of a virtuous woman, virtue, has to do with godly character and Christ-likeness. Virtue becomes a garden from which our qualities will bloom and blossom and grow. And by the way, God commands every man to go and find a virtuous woman. You know, if you young men is looking for a wife, go find a virtuous woman. You don't need one that's given to parties and recklessness, because that's exactly what the home's going to be. Amen. Unless they get things right with God. You see, find a virtuous woman. A virtuous woman has a heart for God and wants to live a holy life for God. When she finds out what Christ wants, she does it. And by the way, can I tell you, the Bible tells us how a virtuous woman will conduct herself, and not only conduct herself, but how they'll dress. I want you to open your Bible to me to a couple places here. While we're in, while we're over in the book of 2 Peter, go to 1 Timothy. 1 Timothy chapter 2 and verse number 9. Now, you could read more into this by reading this chapter, but look at verse number 9. For it says, in like manner also, that women adorn themselves in modest apparel, with shamefacedness and sobriety, not with broided hair or gold or pearls or costly array. In other words, you ought to have decency in what you wear. We ought not to run around here half naked. We ought to dress ourselves properly, not to draw any attention to ourselves. That's what the scriptures tells us, and that's what's pleasing unto God. Many of the women today, and young women especially, want to parade around and catch the eyes of the young men, but that's not pleasing to God. That's not God's way. God will send you what you need if you'll trust in Him. And mom, we ought to tell our young girls, you can't wear that. That's okay. I mean, it's okay to say you can't go out here wearing that. Right? I mean, it begins at home, by the way. And so go with me now to back to Proverbs chapter number 7. Let's look at these scriptures. Proverbs 7, verse 8, 9, and 10. Bible says, passing through the street near her corner, and I was talking about the woman, and she went the way to her house in the twilight, in the evening, in the black and dark night. And behold, there met him a woman with the attire of an harlot, unsettled in heart. You see, by the way they dress, you know where their heart is. By what they wear, you can tell about where their heart is. And so we ought to give, especially if we're a Christian, a Christian woman, or to give the appearance of a Christian woman. It was Paul in the book of Titus. Go over to the book of Titus. It was Paul over here in the book of Titus that addressed men, and then he addressed women, addressed them in Titus chapter 2 and verse 3, 4, and 5. Notice what he says. The aged woman, that's the elderly woman, that's the woman with some wisdom, that's the woman who's been through some things, that's the woman maybe who made bad choices and learned some things. By the way, we can teach people from our own experience sometime. But the aged woman, likewise, that they be in behavior as becometh holiness, not false accusers, not given to much wine, teachers of good things, examples, that they may teach the young women to be sober, to love their husbands and to love their children, to be discreet, chaste, keepers at home, good, obedient to their own husbands, that the word of God be not blasphemed. Why is he saying all these? Why is it that he's recommending that the aged women live the example before the young women, so the young women will know how to conduct themselves and will know how to love their homes and to love their family and to bring God into the house? Why? Because so God will not be blasphemed with our life. So we will not bring down the name of God, so we will not bring down the house of God, so God will be pleased with what we're doing. So the heart of this virtuous woman, who can find a virtuous woman? Well, it begins in her heart. She's made her mind up. She's made her mind up to serve God. She's made her mind up to be a child of God. She's made her mind up to lead her home in the knowledge, in the fear and admonition of the Lord. There is some things that a virtuous woman will not allow to take place in their house. And so that's the heart of a virtuous woman. Now, our lesson deals with the husband of a virtuous woman. Notice back in Proverbs chapter 31 again, if you will. And let's go back there. And verse number 11. The heart of her husband doth safely trust in her, so that he shall have no need of spoil. The first thing we see in the husband of a virtuous woman is he trusts her. The heart of her husband will trust her. He's got no reason not to trust her. She's faithful. She does what she's supposed to do. You see, the man, you turn the page and you take a man who is married to a woman who is constantly trying to turn the heads of other men, who constantly is going here and going there and don't know where they're at half the time. He often has a miserable husband because they don't know what their wife's doing or where they are. And their attention is usually to somebody else instead of their own husband. But you see, every virtuous wife, that's a virtuous wife, deserves a God-honoring, spirit-filled husband. But on the other side, every Christian man, a God-fearing man, deserves a virtuous wife that he can trust. And see, this brings the unity in the house. There can't be no unity, can't be no peace when a husband and wife don't trust each other. Can there? Can't be. It has to be miserable. It has to be living in fear and all those things all the time. But a virtuous woman, the heart of her husband doth safely trust in her. Proverbs, flip back a few pages to Proverbs 12 and verse number 4. The Bible says here, a virtuous woman is a crown to her husband. You know what that is? That's something he's proud of. That's something that, of course, a crown is an accomplishment. You know, it's something you've won, that you're proud of. You see, and so the Bible says here that a virtuous woman is a crown unto her husband. Someone he's proud of and adorns and wears and is proud for people to see. But the rest of that verse says this, but she that maketh ashamed is as rottenness in his bones. So if there's no trust and they're ashamed, then of course there's no good ever going to come from that. So a virtuous woman is a tremendous blessing to her husband. And wives, if you want a happy husband, be a virtuous woman. And men, if you want a happy wife, be a virtuous husband. Be faithful. By the way, being virtuous doesn't mean that you have to live dull. It doesn't mean you have to live ugly. Amen? That ain't what that means. You know, I've heard people say, well, y'all, you Baptists want the women with no makeup and straight hair. And that ain't what it means. I don't know where they got that from. Now, we like them decked up pretty, right? But you know, modestly and good. But it doesn't, what it means is you're proud, you know. And I'm not saying you're prideful, but you're, you know. You know why we comb our hair of a morning? Why we brush our teeth? So we won't be embarrassed when we go out the door. Amen? There is some work that has to be done. And people like me, it takes a long time to work it up. But anyway, the most beautiful people in the world are those who have the beauty of the Lord upon them. Not the world, but the beauty of God upon them. Psalm 90. Let's turn over to Psalm 90 just a moment. Psalm 90 and verse 17. And let the beauty of the Lord our God be upon us, and establish thou the work of our hands upon us. Yea, the work of our hands establish thou it. So we need to let the beauty of God shine through our everyday life. When we go out the door, we ought to be an example. We're children of God. We ought to look like children of God. We ought to look like children of the devil. We ought to look like children of Satan. You know, and I've been in trouble before by saying things probably I shouldn't say, but I don't think it's a good example when we go out of the out of the house adorned in gothic stuff and metal hanging all out of our face. I don't believe that's a godly example. You see? Matter of fact, that's an ungodly example. Men, I don't think you ought to wear earrings. Okay, you know, right? What would you think if I had an earring on here tonight? Huh? There'd be some questions asked, wouldn't he? I don't know how long I'd live, but anyway, I better finish up while I'm still winning the game. Okay, our last topic in this lesson is the home of a virtuous woman. We've seen the heart of a virtuous woman. We've seen the husband of a virtuous woman. Now the heart. Now let's go back to Proverbs 31. And we're going to read a few more verses here, beginning in verse 13. We're going to read down through verse 27. She seeketh wool and flax and worketh willingly with her hands. She is like a merchant's ship. She bringeth her food from afar. She riseth also while it is yet night and giveth meat to her household and a portion to her maidens. She considereth a field and buyeth it. With the fruit of her hands she planteth a vineyard. She girdeth her loins with strength and strengtheneth her arms. She perceiveth that her merchandise is good. Her candle goeth not out by night. She layeth her hands to the spindle and her hands hold the distaff. She stretcheth out her hand to the poor. Yea, she reacheth forth her hands to the needy. She is not afraid of the snow for her household, for all her household are clothed with scarlet. She maketh herself coverings of tapestry. Her clothing is silk and purple. Her husband is known in the gates when he sitteth among the elders of the land. She maketh fine linen and selleth it and delivereth girdles unto the merchant. Strength and honor are her clothing, and she shall rejoice in time to come. She openeth her mouth with wisdom, and in her tongue is the law of kindness. She looketh well to the ways of her household and eateth not the bread of idleness. So what we get here, the home of a virtuous woman is a busy place. And it's the woman, the mother, that makes that a busy place. You know, she's rise up before the sun does to see that what's needed in the house is there. And the kids are taken care of and the husband's taken care of. And the home really should be the first place of importance to the woman. Now, I know there's a lot of people, most families today, they're both has to work, and they work outside the home, and that's most of the case if you're going to make it in this day's society. That's usually the way it is. But that doesn't mean we can neglect the home. You see, the woman still should make her home priority. Now, men, we should help them. If that's the case and they're working as much as we're working, well, we ought to pitch in and help. Amen. Ladies, amen. I know you guys ain't saying much amen to that, are you? But anyway, you know, wash the dishes, do the laundry, mop the floor, and then mow the grass. You see? You work together. Because, well, that's how it goes. And but home ought to be the priority. And I know it is of the mother, of the woman, to see that the home is right and that it's good. And then men would love the wives and help them. And ladies, you're to put the husband and the home in the proper order and as God has put it, as a matter of fact. Now, verse 28 of this chapter says, her children arise up and call her blessed. So their children have a testimony for them. The virtuous woman will be the praise of her home. You know, your children will praise you. They'll remember the things that you've done in the home. And it hopefully will bleed over to them, and they'll carry that on in their families as they come. Ladies, if you live a good, godly life, and guide your home by the way God tells you, your children will rise up and call you blessed. They'll not forget it. And matter of fact, your husband goes on saying that verse, and her husband also, and he praiseth her. And so the husband will praise the wife, and the godly home will be forever settled. You see, the problem today is we want to get so many things in our home, and the devil's got all kind of entertainment toys. From easy, convenient cell phones to internet to, I mean, there's all kind of gadgets. And these, I'm not saying these things are bad, but these things are often a deterrent to do what is right, because the devil can introduce so many things wrong across those things. Now, they're good and they can be used for good things, but there's also a danger there. So we have to be careful in today's society what we're allowing within the house. Verse 30. It says, favor is deceitful and beauty is vain, but a woman that feareth the Lord, she shall be praised. The number one priority in any life, especially the virtuous woman, is God pleased with what I'm doing? Is God being honored by what we're doing in our home? And that's the question we must ask. Is what we're doing, or even what we've done today, did it honor God and please God in some way? Who can find a virtuous woman? For her price is far above rubies. The most valuable thing you can ever be today, ladies, is to be a God-fearing woman that trusts the Lord and follows the Lord and believes what God has said. So let's strive to be just that, a virtuous woman. And we won't have a perfect home, but you'll have a God-fearing home. And that's what we need. Amen. Thank you. God bless you. And Pastor Mays will be back just in a moment.
All right, we're going to finish our last class up here teaching the Bible tonight. Now, before we move on into lesson number 8, did y'all remember to do your homework in lesson number 7? All right, let's go back to page, it's 18 in my book, but it'll be the first page of last week's lesson, and we're going to find a pattern in the Bible, looking for a central theme. And so you had 1, 2, 3, 4 passages of scriptures to look at. We did John 4:34 in class last week. And of course, I can't hear you guys at home that's watching live stream, but I want you to be looking. But I'm going to ask the people that are here tonight what they found, and there's no right or wrong answer. But as you were reading these passages of scriptures, what was the theme, or what theme jumped out at you? And so we're going to look at that. And John 3, our first one, John 3, 3 through 21. What did y'all get for that? Y'all just blurted out. We're not being formal here. Huh? Salvation. Anybody else get something?
I just said being born again.
Being born again, okay. So see, that's how we look at things. It both are the same, but we could, as a teacher, so we're talking about teaching the Bible, we could take that many different directions. And so I put, you must be born again. And so salvation, that's the same thing. And so that's definitely the topic that Jesus is talking about. Okay, we did John 4 in class, but what about John 5? 17 through 47. That would maybe be a little bit more tough. But what did you get out of that?
Believing
that Jesus is the Son of God. What? Somebody else? That's right. And if you look at all those things, the Word of God, John the Baptist, the miracles, they all prove that Jesus was the Christ, the Son of God. And so that's right. And so they were witnesses or proofs that Jesus is God. And so that's kind of the theme of that chapter. What about chapter 6, verse 30 through 58? Famous chapter of the Bible. Jesus is the bread of life. Okay, again, dealing with salvation, because really, in about every chapter in the book of John, he's going to deal with salvation. And so Jesus is the bread of life, that whole discourse on Jesus, the bread of life. What about Acts chapter 8, verse 30 through 35? Jesus is the Lamb of God. He's the Messiah. He's the Christ. And so definitely pointing to Jesus as the Lamb of God, the Messiah, the Lord Jesus Christ, fulfilling the Old Testament prophecy. Well, let's move on tonight to our lesson number 8. Okay, to the world of the Bible and back. To the world of the Bible and back again. And so every time that you get ready to teach, and what we're going to talk about tonight, if this kind of doesn't make sense to you tonight, every time that you teach the Bible, you have to go travel into the Bible to learn about the Bible, and then bring back from those ancient times and those ancient cultures when it was written, and bring that truth and the Bible truth that was written many centuries ago. It's still applicable to today. So it's our job as teachers to bring that truth out, even though it was written those many years ago, and apply it to today. So that's the title of our lesson, To the World of the Bible and Back. The Bible teacher faces the challenge of showing students how the remote world of the Bible, you know, people say, well, you know, that was ancient time. What does that have to do with today? Well, the times and the customs and the manners and the people may have been ancient people, but can I tell you today, Bible truth is the same as it was then. It's the same as it ever was. It ever will be. And so the Bible relates to our own experiences and present day life. Sometimes this is called bridging the gap, because there's often a gap of understanding between the events we read in Scripture and the life of it that we live today. And so the Bible teacher, your job, whether it be a parent, grandparent, Sunday school teacher, a master club worker, bus minister, whatever you do, your job is to connect that gap, to make those truths from the Bible, even though it was written many years ago, relevant for today. How does this apply to today? How can I take this and apply it to my life? Okay? Now, so for an example, I'm going through teen church right now. I've told you in Hebrews chapter 11. And so even though we're going to talk about Abraham, we talked about Noah and Enoch and Abel and what they did many, 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 many years ago. How does that apply to us? Well, the same faith they had is the same faith we have to have today. And so we have to bring that, bridge that gap. Now, there's not many scriptures in our lesson tonight, but I don't like to teach a Bible lesson without giving you a scripture. So I want you to turn to Ezekiel, the book of Ezekiel, chapter 22. And you probably remember this from Pastor's Bible study of Ezekiel. But Ezekiel chapter 22 and verse number 30, talking about bridging this gap. "And I sought for a man among them that should make up the hedge and stand in the gap before me for the land, that I should not destroy it, but I found none." And so we have a great responsibility as Bible teachers, and whether that be in the home, as parents or grandparents, whether that be in the church, in whatever aspect of ministry you have that God's given you. Remember we said that we're Bible teachers everywhere we go, work, wherever. So we have that responsibility to bridge that gap, to make the Bible relevant for today. It doesn't mean change the Bible. We're not saying that in any way, shape, or form. But to be able to convey the same truth that God gave them, the same truth without change, how does it apply to us today? The same way. Okay, let's look at the world of the Bible. Number one, the Bible teacher must take a journey to the world of the Bible and back. He or she must leave his present world behind and go to the ancient lands and walk among the people and become participant in the events of Scripture. You know, I like to, when I'm reading these Bible stories, put myself there. The children of Israel, I try to put myself there at the Red Sea. What would that look like? Pharaoh's army closing in from the side, wilderness on both sides, mountains, and then looking at a sea, and then all of a sudden to see that. Try to put yourself in those Bible stories. What would it have been like to be in the crowd to see Lazarus raised from the dead, or to see Jesus as he was crucified? Put yourself in those situations. Okay, here's some blanks for you. The teacher must relive the text. There's your blank. As a teacher, you must relive the text. Put yourself into it. Who was there? What were they doing? How did they feel about it? What were the reactions of others? And so, in any of these Bible stories, we were talking about the, I had to teach the third grade class last night in Master Club, and I had two little ones, and we were talking about David and Goliath. And so, I'm not a very good artist, but I took the chalkboard there, I had chalk, and I said, huh. And so I drew a stick figure of Goliath, and I showed him the valley, and I drew a stick figure of David, and tried to put him in the story. And so, get them, especially the young people, get them in the story. I call up, more so, you know, in the past where we was able to have big Master Club groups, I'd call volunteers up, and we would play out Bible stories and act them out, getting them involved, putting yourself in that story. The teacher must, the next one, picture as much as possible how things were in Bible times. The teacher must picture as much as possible how things were in Bible times. And we're going to talk about some books later about how to do this, but I'll give you some as we go through. This, what it's talking about here, if you're studying the Bible, you're interested in studying the Bible, teaching the Bible, I would encourage you to get some books on the customs and manners of the Bible. Customs and manners. I have a book by a man by the name of Freeman. I think it listed in your book. Very, very good. It goes through different chapters of the Bible, and it talks about, I'm just thinking off the top of my head, like the signet ring, and it talks about the significance of pottery and why they did this and why they did that, and it gives you an insight of those customs in that day and what they did, and like a marriage ceremony and things like that. So what did the people wear? How did they look? What were their homes like? What were their cities like? What was their transportation like? And so that's why I really like this new manners and customs of the Bible by this man by the name of Freeman. He goes into a lot of that. It's very good. And another man I was reading after not long ago, I have several of his big books. His name's Edersham, and I got Brother Gene, Stephanie, I got his old book. His son Alan gave to my dad, and dad gave it to me. It was Pastor Gene Harmon's, a big book about that thick, but talking about the lives and times of Jesus the Messiah. And he goes into detail about when I was teaching on the Passover, about how these Passover rooms, what they would do to fit them out, and all these things, these details and customs that you just wouldn't get reading the Bible. If you dig deeper and study a little bit about their culture and history, it makes the Bible just makes so much more sense to you. So there's a lot of things to do that. And so put yourself in the story. That's really the primary topic tonight. Letter A, Consider the geography and the topography included in the text. The geography. The geography. I know Pastor has been talking about in the book of Jeremiah, there in the valley of Tophet or the valley of Hinnom outside of Jerusalem, and how that relates to Christ's teaching on hell and that burning dump and the topography and how the geography was. And so use that. The mountains. Study some of the mountains of the Bible. Interesting things. Where is this event taking place? What do we know about this place from the passage or from history? So a lot of things you can do is studying geography in the Bible. All right, letter B, consider all the physical and tangible things mentioned in the text. And again, this is a lot about Bible methods of Bible study, kind of. We're going back over some things. In the initial stage, we're not preoccupied with spiritual meaning. We are simply seeking to pay attention to the details, what's taking place. So before we can bring that spiritual truth out to make it relative for today, we have to kind of put ourselves in the Bible story, know what's going on, and understanding the physical things. You know, I've told you, when I look at a text or a verse, I try to squeeze it like a grape and get everything that I can out of it. What's going on in the background? Who's speaking? What are they doing? And then, from all of that, then bringing it all together to get to your spiritual truth. So the geography, and a good reference to do this is a good Bible dictionary. We'll give you some here as we close tonight. Good Bible dictionary help you do this. C, on the next page, consider the cultural context. Cultural context of the text. What ancient customs or practices were prevalent at the time of the setting? And again, you can find this in the manners and customs and Bible dictionaries. And so there's not really one exclusive source. There's many types of information out there. And a lot of this stuff, I tell you what, you can bypass the bookstore, but you have to be very, very careful. There's a lot of stuff available online. There's a lot of good stuff available online, and there's a lot of garbage when it comes to theology available online. So you better know your Bible before you go getting a bunch of stuff off. Oh, look what I found off the line. Nobody else talks about this, but man, this guy explains everything. You better be careful because he might be out in left field biblically, all right? So know kind of who you're reading after. If you go to a website, I would highly encourage you. Usually most websites that you visit will have a About Us page, and if they're a ministry, you'll have their statement of faith, and you read what they believe and what they're telling you. So just be careful about what you get off the internet. Well, just be careful what you read after, period. But usually when it comes to Bible references and Bible dictionaries and stuff, you know, there's a lot of different ones, good ones out there to use. So understand the culture, what's going on. You know, the culture, you know, especially I'm thinking, I don't know, I just can't get this out of my head. You know, when Jesus talked about the bridegroom and the bride and the virgins trimming their lamp and all those things, if you study what that means in the Bible times, it makes that story make a whole lot more sense. And there's many, many other cultural things you can study in the Bible. Letter D, consider the ideas and attitudes of the author and characters, or who's the biblical author and the characters. And so what are their ideas and attitudes? What were these characters thinking? What were their prejudices or opinions, okay? And so what were they thinking? Think about Judas Iscariot, you know, that night, the Lord's Passover. You know, all the other disciples are interested in what the Lord has to say, but what's Judas interested in? He's only interested in the money. He's only interested in betraying Christ. He has one. He's not. He could care less what Jesus has to say. And so, you know, just put yourself into their situation. Here's some helpful resources to take on your journey to the world of the Bible. Bible maps. And again, these are just some recommended things that you can have. If you wanted to, you could fill up a whole library room with Bible reference things, okay? And so they recommend the Baker's Bible Atlas, especially for Bible maps, okay? Bible Dictionary, an Unger's Bible Dictionary. I have one of those, and it's very good. I have some of the old Oliver B. Green Bible dictionaries. I have some from the old Liberty when Jerry Falwell was there many, many years ago, and they were still pretty solid, and they weren't, I'm just going to, I have some good references from them that are good, and so a lot of good things, and so there's a lot of good things out there. Bible Handbook, World's Bible Handbook, they recommend, that's just one of them. Customs book, this is the book that I have. I really recommend this. Freeman's Manners and Customs of the Bible. And so give you a lot of insight of these good Bible truths, okay? And there's many, many others out there. But just make sure who you're reading after, whether it be on the internet or in a book. I highly caution you who you're reading after, okay? And then number two, the world in which we live. And by the way, if you have a question about something, feel free to come to Pastor Mills or I, and we'll give you the guidance that we know. Maybe we're familiar, maybe we're not. Maybe we can help you do some looking to see if it's a good source or not. But number two, the world in which we live, okay? Now, after we go to the Bible, let's bring this truth that the Bible is bringing relevant to today. So after traveling to the Bible world, how does the teacher effectively relate the things that he has seen to modern day hearers, okay? Letter A, explain words that are not easily understood. Some words need definitions. Others need explanation in everyday terms, okay? A Strong's Concordance is a good thing to use. Bringing things into everyday vernacular, you know, okay? So if I'm talking to my young people, teenagers, about propitiation, what am I going to, am I just going to talk about propitiation all night, or am I going to try to explain what that means first and then teach from there? We're going to try to bring it into our vernacular, okay? We're not changing truth. Now, we're not telling you changing truth to adapt to culture. That's not what we're saying. We're telling you that the Bible teacher must be able to take these truths that were written many years ago, which still apply to today, and make them relevant. How did these stories affect the people in their day? How do they affect us in our day? You'll find out that human beings have always been human beings. We share the same experiences no matter what time period or culture that we've been in, okay? And so there's a lot of relative truth there. Well, the Bible is all truth, and we're not saying that the Bible doesn't apply. We're trying to teach you that you need to be able to bring that truth and make it apply to today, because it still works today. It's still truth today. It's unchanging truth of God's Word. Okay, so explain words that are not easily understood. And then letter B, find a current counterpart to help explain unfamiliar ideas. Okay, this does not need to be taken to the extreme, but we can reference someone or something in modern day as a representative of something in the Bible days, okay? And I've got written down some examples here in my book. What we mean of that is you know, let's talk about now, for instance, I use me a lot because I know me better than anybody else, right? And so we're teaching the teenagers on Sunday nights out of Hebrews chapter 11, the faith chapter, what that these men and women did by faith and through faith. You'll find it all through the book. Okay, but how can I make that more, you know, into modern times or modern day? How can I make that apply to them? Well, I could give an example of a man like George Mueller that prayed and he had faith in God at that orphanage, and God provided that milk for him, and God provided, and so many, many examples that we can use. That's what we're talking about. You know, I'm not just going to get up and teach about George Mueller. We're going to talk about the Bible and how Abraham used faith, but we can use modern examples and even more recent than that. Talking about prayer, I've told you in here about the man by the name of John Hyde, Praying Hyde. Talked about him, could talk about him, that missionary. Other preachers, D.L. Moody, Charles Spurgeon, there's many things talking about a modern counterpart, but we're not going to preach about the counterpart. They said don't take it to an extreme. Our message is not about them. We have to go back to the Bible. Keep the Bible the central thing. Remember, we talked about that a few weeks ago. But we can use illustrations and examples, okay? Recent missionary biographies, recent, you know, different things. All right, letter C. Recognize the common human experience in the biblical text. Recognize the common human experience in the biblical text. People are people. There always have been, always will be. Even though we are living in different time and culture, we have the same human experience that all people for all time have. Love, joy, worship, prayer. I mean, those are things that are common to the human experience, okay? Tears, broken heart, sin. There's things that the Bible is still very relevant on. Everything in the Bible is relevant for today. Not just bits and pieces. It's all relevant. But as the Bible teacher, it's our job to show how that is, okay? So on the last page, what are these common human experiences that all people in time can relate to? Well, number one, physical needs, hunger, thirst, weariness, pain, okay? That's always been an issue. That's of the human experience. So, relate things in the physical sense. You know, Jesus sat down in the well. He was tired. He was weary. He was hungry. He thirsted. He slept, okay? Number two, Emotional expressions have always been common. Love, sadness, joy, discouragement. Peter went out and wept bitterly. Okay, sadness, and then love. Okay, all those things. Emotional expressions. Number three, moral decisions. Moral decisions. Lying, immorality, like we were talking about tonight in 1 Corinthians. Okay, moral decisions. So we're talking about things common to the human experience, no matter what time, what culture, whether it be in the Bible days or now, that's still relevant. Okay, number four, spiritual experiences, worship of God, prayer to God, okay? It's always the same as it's always been. Jesus' teaching on prayer is the same as it was the day that He taught it, okay? And worship. We must worship God that way. Number five, relationships with other people. We talked about the home, husband and wife, brothers and sisters, siblings, friendships, okay? Human relationships, all part of the human experience. And we can use that as Bible teachers talking about bridging that gap between those ancient times and modern times. The truth is the same, but we got to be able to, as the Bible teacher, pull that truth out from those ancient times and bring it into the audience that we are teaching. Every time you teach the Bible, you must take a two-way trip to the world of the Bible and back, okay? So you can't just go to the Bible and stay there, all right? You got to be able to go there and bring that back to help somebody else and show them Christ. The Bible is never out of date and it's never irrelevant. You know, there's not just parts of the Bible that's pertinent today. It's all relevant to us, okay, in some way, shape, or form. Remember when we look at a Bible text, what are the three things we learn that we have to look at every Bible text in what three ways? Historically, prophetically, and spiritually, what's the spiritual application? Every verse of the Bible, we need to look at it that way. Okay, and it's our job as a teacher to show how relevant it truly is. So it's not a question, is the Bible relevant today? It is relevant. It's our job to show our students how. Whether it be your children, grandchildren, kids in the church, teaching adult Sunday school class, doesn't matter. We as Bible teachers have to be able to relate Bible truth. That's the whole goal of this class, to relate Bible truth to our students, okay? We thank you for joining with us tonight, and we will be back again next Thursday. Our mission conference is this week. So next Thursday, our next School of the Bible class, number 9. So 9, 10, 11, 12, four more classes, and we will be finished this semester. And spring is on the way. Amen. Let's pray and we'll be dismissed. Heavenly Father, we thank you for the night, the School of the Bible, those who have come, those who have listened. Father, we pray there'll be a blessing, a help and encouragement to somebody. In Jesus' name, amen. God bless you and have a good night.